In desperation, he decided he would return home and ask to be a servant. He was unaware of the depth of his father's love. Little did he know that his father had been longing for him, waiting and watching for the day he would return. As the young man made his way home, his father spotted him, even when he was still a long way off, and ran to him, embraced him, and kissed him affectionately. Filthy and ragged, the repentant young man confessed to his father his sinful life, telling him that he was no longer worthy to be his son. But his father responded by first clothing him with the best robe, and then sacrificing the fattened calf to feed him. With rejoicing, he called for a feast, for all to celebrate the return of his son, whom he declared had been dead and now lived again, who had been lost and was now found. Like the son in this parable, each of us will eventually come to the realization that we are lost and need to be found by God, our real Father. We may feel too ashamed to come to God, but the Bible reveals his unchanging and infinite love for us. He longs for every prodigal to come back to himself. In God's eyes, to be lost is actually to be dead in sins.
This morning, I'd like to take time with you to examine what has been a story we're pretty much acquainted with. But if we are looking at it, not necessarily from its initial perspective. The story of Prodigal Son. Let me make sure we all understand. The main reason for the giving of this parable by Jesus was to teach the self-righteous Pharisees that God is rich in mercy and towards every sinner who comes to him. Remember, it started off, Jesus was having a meal. He's having a meal with sinners, with publicans, with people that are considered on the outskirts of the religious community. And Jesus starts to share about lostness, whether that is a coin, whether that is a sheep. And then he goes and he talks about this son who's lost. So that's the primary focus. It's about how God loves sinners, amen? How he yearns to receive unto himself his children. But I'd like to do this. I'd like for us to look at the story of the prodigal son from the perspective of the father. What can we learn as parents, especially focusing on parents whose children have rebelled? I'm not going to ask you to put your hand if you have a child that has rebelled. I'm not. Don't do that. But it is likely that you have. It's likely that you have been a rebellious child yourself. And it is possible that you may have rebellion at some point in your parenting experience. In fact, what I'd like for us to look at is this aspect of how, as a parent, we deal with this. There's probably nothing more painful for Christian parents than to have one of your children rebel against the Lord and against you. In fact, it is stated that you could almost cope more easily, not saying it's easy, but more easily with the death of a child because there's some sense of closure than to deal with the rebellion and an ongoing rebellion of a son or daughter. And so the question is, how should Christian parents respond toward children who rebel? Now, I can tell you that as a human, and last thing I have noticed is I'm still human. I believe I will always be human. But the tendency in my own, and I believe it's a tendency in us as humans, as parents, is that when we are experiencing, facing that rebellion in a son or daughter or child, we tend to withdraw emotionally in order to protect oneself. Or we get angry. We get angry, we lash out. There was a sign in a health clinic, and it was actually a pediatric clinic, and it said this: avenge yourself. Live long enough to become a problem to your children. I thought that's interesting. It reminded me of in my upbringing, what I heard from my own mom. When we were acting up, she would say, "No te preocupes, mi hijo. Do not worry, my son. Tu día vendrá. Your day will come." You ever heard that? It might have been in a different accent. But the idea behind it was, yours will come, yours will come. But you know, that may be tempting, but as Christians, parents, we must ask, how would God have me act? How would He have me behave in this difficult situation? And even if, say, your children haven't gone off, and they're not in deep end in rebellion, every parent has to deal with kids who hurt us with wrong behavior. So how should we relate to our children as Christian parents? Amen? Because we're believers. Our life is different because of Jesus. Praise the Lord. Amen. And that means that everything in our lives must be faced from the perspective, belonging to Jesus, what am I to do? And this area is an important area. And so, in the parable of the prodigal, the father is who? Who is the father?
God,
absolutely. The father, Jesus used this story telling us about God and God's response towards sinners. So we see that. Over and over, when you open the scriptures, you find that God is our father. And so if he's our father, it's simple. What's the next part of it? We are his children. So here is God, how he relates to his children. God relates to me as his child, so I can learn from that and how I'm to relate to my children. Amen? That's vital. And so one of the things we find is that hurting parents must demonstrate God's love and forgiveness to their children. Did you get that? Hurting parents. And by the way, you hurt, maybe you're hurting, or if not, you will hurt. Hurting parents must demonstrate God's love and forgiveness to their children. Now, you know, the parable doesn't go into teaching us how do I discipline my child, our children. It doesn't go into, you know, in the parable, you don't see that, do you? How many here have read the parable of the prodigal son? I think almost everyone, right? And I even showed a little video. Thank you for showing that. So that we could remember the story, although they didn't have subways back then, but it was to bring it home, right? Bring it home for our day and age, right? Okay, so in this parable, we don't have discipline, and discipline is vital. In fact, notice the word discipline is really the long version of another word. What's at the heart of that word? To what?
Disciple.
So when we are disciplined, we are being discipled. And when we discipline, we are also to disciple. We are to disciple. Now, the question, of course, is you are discipling, but in whose image are you trying to disciple? The goal is redemptive. The goal is to help impact the character of that son, daughter in rebellion, where they are in their lives. So So discipline is vital. The tendency, and I'll tell you my own, we're called to discipline our children. I believe that the tendency in disciplining a child or a daughter, son or daughter, is sometimes to be very harsh. And I believe the tendency is that we tend to go to the extreme. Anybody can relate to that? You don't gotta tell me the story, but can you relate? Yeah, right? When I was disciplined as a child, it all depended who, but I would cry forever. It was the end of the world for me. And it was, oh man, have mercy, have mercy. So when I come to this point of discipline, let's say Jane, who might have decided this is a good point to exit because she knew I would mention, but when Jane disciplines, and no problem because we've talked about this and she's heard this, she is merciful. She will point out and say, here is the consequence for that action. I, as a father, will say, thank you. I like it, un poquito. And I want to add about 10 more things to the punishment. So the tendency is to go overboard. You know, it's like, no, you cannot watch your TV. No, you do not get the cell phone. And stop breathing, no more oxygen. Something, you know, to the extreme. And it goes overboard. But we realize God's love and grace are the greatest motivation for our obedience. And it's the same with our children. God's the love and grace. I want my kids to know that God is gracious and loving because they see in me, they have an experience that I demonstrate to them that same love and that same grace as well. So, before we look at love and forgiveness here in the parable, we need to look at hurt. Because I said parents hurt when their children are rebellious, when they're in deep rebellion as well. This father in this story was hurting. Do you agree with that? Every parent, you, myself, we all have expectations. I mean, after you counted that the at least all the fingers and the toes were there on the day your child came into the world, even before, you had already high hopes. You started thinking, you started dreaming, you have these aspirations for your child. And so every parent desires that their kid would grow up and embrace your values, that of your family, that which you may have received from your parents. Every parent, every Christian parent wants his children to be not a leech, right? Not known chupacabra, a blood drinker, a vampire, somebody that just feeds and feeds, but somebody who contributes, makes a difference in life, in society, and especially for the cause of Jesus Christ. Amen? And so the pain runs deep when a child rebels. This pain, this dolor, and in Spanish, I think it's even more painful when I have to say it in Spanish, dolor. It goes deep. In fact, there's three components to this. One is, it's the pain of rejection. It hurts because the parent feels rejected. And so rejection of you as a person in verse 12. Somebody have verse 12 from the passage, Luke 15. Look at verse 12, right? What does it say in verse 12? Somebody, I want you to participate with me. There you go. All right. Let's read it. The young one said to his father, Father, give me what? My share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. And so the tendency would be to go quickly without stopping to consider the tremendous pain the son's actions, what this means for the father. Do you know the implication of the words? I want mine. I want what's coming to me now. Ahora. If the father had raised the issue, but the son is the one that's raising. Can you imagine your niña, your bambino coming to you? Okay? Young adult, teenager. It doesn't tell us the age. And he says, Dad, and basically what he's saying is, Dad, drop dead. You see, you don't get the inheritance until later. This came when the father died. And it would be given. So what he is saying is, it's over right now. I don't want you more living and among the living. I just want what's rightfully coming to me. So if we take it in, he's saying that he doesn't care for his father. All I want is your money. Give it to me now so I can get out of here and I can enjoy myself without you around. There's a Dr. Kenneth Bailey who studied this. Now, folks, this guy studied this for over 20 years. Have you studied a passage of the Bible or a parable for 20 years? Some of you haven't been there yet in 20 years, and others we passed, we haven't done it. This guy studied it for 20 years, and this is what he says. He says that as he studied, and he's lived in the Near East, and he studied the culture, he says there is no example in history or in the culture of a son asking for his inheritance before the father's death. And so he said the closest thing he found is in Iran. It says of a situation, he says the parents were so shocked, they viewed the son's action as basically saying, I just wish you dead. That's how shocking it is for the culture and the background of where this comes from, this passage, for something like this to even be done, conceived. So we have the rejection of you as a person. Father feels rejected. The rejection is not only of him, but it's also the rejection of your heritage. It's a rejection of your heritage. When you think of your heritage, you know, we say, la familia, the family, my family. You know, when you think of, there was this guy who went and he said he wanted to get rid of the family name. Can you imagine that? To get rid of the family name. I remember when we got married, Jane and I, and she went to do all the paperwork, her maiden name is Espronza, and you know, she kept it. And I was like, why? You don't want my last name? And she said, but I love my last name still. And then they were sending me mail that said, Mr. Estranza, and that really got to me. Anyway, but you know, to reject, and so in this case, it's a rejection of heritage. Dr. Bailey says that the inheritance would have been primarily what? The family land, which was passed down from one generation to another. They were a farming community, right? Society. The father would have taken the land, he divided it, and he would have given it to the son. The son would have had to go and sell that piece of land, would have gotten money in exchange, of course. And so to do that meant that other people had heard your son, your child, taking and selling it, and you're alive. So basically, it's out of the box. It's not in a box anymore. Everyone else knows what your child has done. And so this is public. This action, I don't want to live here. I don't want to raise my family. I want nothing to do with this household. It's a rejection of the heritage. It would be like, I think of, you remember that lady who, and I just bring it because it was in the public awareness, news coverage, She was working for the NAACP. You remember that? And she had this position there. Now, by all outward appearance, she looked African-American. She looked black. She acted, she integrated into the community, she represented, until her parents, her white parents, said, she is lying. She's not black. And so this became, you know, and they said she rejected her heritage. And what are the parents? The parents are hurting. They're angry. There's a lot of stuff there, and I'm not going to go into all that because I don't know everything about it. But I'm just using those things. Now, it's not only rejection of his heritage, there is a rejection of his values. The son is rejecting, that child is rejecting the values of the family. And so the boy did not join the local synagogue in that far-off country. And he didn't model his life after his father. Instead, he wasted everything that he had on, you know, loose living, la vida loca. He did all that. He wasted it out there. He wasn't following the Lord. I think that hurts, right? You just picture it. You have taken your child. You remember when your child came, you prayed for that child to come into this world, for its safe delivery, for the mother, for the experience. You provided maybe even homeschooling. You did a little homeschooling. You were with that child on their first day to school. You even made sacrifices and investment and everything possible because you wanted the child to be raised in the Lord. And so you reached out and wanted to provide Christian education, Adventist education. And you saw them involved in everything. And now they're at a point where they don't pray. They don't want anything to do with church service. Even the mention of God seems to be almost something they just resist, and it really touches you. Tears of any godly parent. The father felt the pain of rejection. There is not only that pain of rejection, there's then the pain of humiliation. And I think I told you that it's humiliating because everybody knows now. I don't know about you, but I think within us there's a tendency to be protective of our family issues, right? Unless, you know, like, unfortunately, we live in a day and age where people like to put everything on Facebook. Oh, mercy, they put everything. Dirty diapers on Facebook, dirty panties. Everything goes on Facebook, and you wonder, what is that about? It's about, you know, it could be better. Why? And so, but this son put it out there because of his action and the whole community. So this father was humiliated. You know, for an elderly man, he was respected in the community. But that changed. That changed because it would have been like, so what's happening, Papa? Your kid. You messed up. You messed up, man. Look at this child. Look at this life. And so, some may have criticized the father for permitting it to happen or for not raising his child properly. He would have had to endure whispers before when he came to town, he was admired and respected. And by the way, these towns in the East and where the Bible times, you know, I always thought it's like a New York City. Man, when I started studying a little bit about, you know, the times and biblical or even archaeology reveals, those communities were very small. It was a little barrio, okay? And that little barrio might have had a little bodega. I don't know, I'm just throwing that out there. And so everybody knew everything that was happening there. And chisme, the barrio, you know, the gossip, everything spread. They lived so close to each other that you couldn't. You sneeze, and the person was gesundheit, you know, at night, right there, you know, really close to you.
So everything, so even for him, enduring all that, even to receive the sympathy. Some people are like, pobrecito, oh, papi, you know what's happening to you? You know, this is, oh, I'm so sorry for you. Even to receive that sympathy from people, I bet it was humiliating for him. It hurt him, okay? And so we have that. There's also the pain of guilt. The pain of guilt, the Father represents God, and God, when we look at it, God has no guilt. And I'm going to tell you why. You know why God has no guilt. Because God doesn't do anything wrong. Right? So maybe here is where there's a parting of the way. Even though the parable is about the Father, God doesn't have. But earthly parents, don't we have guilt? Don't we go through that? I mean, our kid gets sick and I'm like, oh, what did I do wrong? Did I put too much salsa in there? I don't know. You start to think of, oh, how I'm contributing. So this father was also wrestling with guilt. The child that's gone, some of it, true guilt, because what parent has not made mistakes and that he would erase if he had been given the chance. But much of it is also false guilt based on the nagging feeling that he has failed. You know, one of the things that I know is that feeling like, I failed. I'm a failure. Oh, I can't believe what's happening right here. The church, especially the community of God, la familia de Dios, we need to play a part in alleviating the pain of hurting parents. We can't do much to lessen the depth of that pain of rejection. Although, you know what we can do? Is we can show acceptance. Amen. We can reach out to parents and be there and let them know. We can help diminish the pain of humiliation and false guilt by not being judgmental. You know, we have to watch it. You know, sometimes it could be the look. Sometimes it could be the word. And sometimes it could be the lack of words, and we might convey judgmentalism, right? And so being careful with that, we need to understand that God, our Heavenly Father, has children who rebel. Hello? No, you didn't hear it. Our Heavenly Father has children that rebel. Okay, if you didn't hear it, can you see it? I'm trying to illustrate. I remember in a church where they were like, Pastor, you know why we got problems? We don't have high standards. The church doesn't have high standards. If we raise the standards, then no one will rebel. And I go, oh, mamma mia, are you crazy? What happened in heaven? The highest standards possible. I agree we should not put down the standards, the values of principles. But God knows what it is to have children who rose up against Him. And so heaven knows. We need to understand that God has faced this, that He's not a failure, but He has seen it. While parental training and influence are major factors, kids also are bombarded, inundated in this world with influences. And you know, our children, we ourselves are facing the influences of our society. We're facing a tug of war, and our kids have this in their body, in their hearts. And never forget, el diablo existe. The devil is real. He exists. The Bible tells us that repeatedly. Even the child from a model Christian home is at best an immature believer who can easily fall into terrible sins. Amen. So godly parents, who to the best of their ability, they want to raise their children in the faith, can still have children who turn away. There is no guarantee. In fact, there's a passage in the Bible, Proverbs 22, verse 6. I'll start it off. Train in the way, and now we just said it, when he's old he will not depart from it. We have understood that, but we have wrongly interpreted to mean that if you train them properly, it is a guarantee that they will follow the Lord. Thus, if the child goes astray, who's to blame? Parent. But the Proverbs are not ironclad promises. Let me say that. The Proverbs are not ironclad promises. They are general maxims about life. It is generally true that if you train up children properly, they will follow the Lord as adults, but it is not guaranteed. And you know why it's not guaranteed? Because when God created and He made us with what? The freedom to choose. And though you and I would love to have that chip taken out of our child, or maybe our spouse, and we would like to insert one that we could program and at a button or whatever voice command, I like that part, but we could get them to do what we want when we want it, that is not so. If there had been obvious parental failure, then we as the church have a responsibility. In fact, yes, there's also parents who are passive and do not discipline their child correctly. That is true. Parents may need guidance and instruction. How can you raise that child in the way of the Lord? How do you discipline that child? The Bible has stories, and I don't have time to go into all that, but it shows us parents who are very permissive. Men of God, hello, who were very permissive. Yes? But we do know that we have a responsibility as a church. We should help a hurting parent to deal biblically with the area of failure. But it is wrong for us. The Lord says, do not judge, for us to be judgmental on others. You know, I gotta say this. I've seen this happen in churches. I cringe. And I'll just use this as an example. Somebody's coming late, and somebody's at the door going, Doesn't that bother you? Because even I don't even know what happened to them. I mean, man, we're struggling in so many ways, and every one of us, we all got issues. I'm the kingpin of issues. And so we all got challenges, but you know, what gives anyone the right to do that? And so the Lord says, you know, for us to be merciful and understanding, and to be there. The father in the parable was also hurt by his older son. Listen, it wasn't just this one who left. Even the one who stayed home. You know how difficult, when you read the rest of the story, the father, when he hears Miroi, and he sees his son coming back. I mean, that father booked out of there. That word's out of use, maybe. But for those who know, remember, book means to run or to move. And he ran towards that son, and he hugged him and embraced him and kissed him and called out, there's going to be a party. It's fiesta time, right? And bring out the nachos. I don't know if they're Mexican, but they were all going to have a great time together and celebrate. And he goes out and he tells, because a brother, the other one that stayed home, he heard about it, but he didn't want anything to do with this whole experience. He despised his brother for leaving. He held it against, and he held himself in high favor. And the father has to appeal. Do you know that in the midst of all this, as it's crowded with people from the community coming out, that the father has to beg publicly the son that stayed home and says, please, your brother was dead. He's alive. Come, let's celebrate. And the son says, why? Why? When am I getting a party? When can I have one for me? Just for me and my friends, not for you, Dad. Wow. He's hurting. That son is also. He stayed. Let's remember when it said, don't judge a book by its cover? Those who stay, even in the house of the Lord, may still have the spirit of rebellion. And so he's accusing the Father, you're unfair. He implicates the Father in the actions when he says, this son of yours, your wealth. He's removing himself in every possible way. He's as distant as the one that went to the far country. You see, he's in the same spot, but his heart is far from home. But in spite of the older son's impudence, the father acted with grace, with love towards him, just as he did toward the prodigal. Though hurting, this father was loving and ready to forgive. Notice the father is ready and loving, and he's ready to forgive. The father's love. This is now about how the father responds. Okay? He's hurting, but he is ready what? To forgive. Let me share with you. What does this mean? Relinquishing without rejection. Relinquishment without rejection. The father let the son go. I mean, listen, what is the natural tendency? I would have said, oh, no. Honey, put a police lock, put everything on that door. You are not stepping foot out of this house. Oh, no way, over my dead body. And he already said he wanted a body dead. So you know, and so the father, he didn't stop him. He did not reject him in his hurt. He could have said, I'll give you your inheritance, but if you take it and you go through those doors, I never want to see your face again. He granted his young adult son the respect of making decisions, even poor decisions. We sat here, many of us and others who joined us, when we talked about religious freedom. See, religious freedom is not an event that happens on a given Sabbath in a year at the church. Amen. Religious freedom must also be religious freedom in our homes. Amen? Amen. In our family, with our spouse, with our children, with one another in the house of God. And so the father, he could have done all that. He grants that son respect, even though it's poor decisions, without rejecting. The younger the child, the more parents must control the child's choices. Yes, you gotta watch it. You know, God put us in charge and made us guardians for the well-being of the child. And yes, you have to watch. Parents, watch the friendships your children have. That is vital area to watch and guard over. I could say more, but you know what I'm saying. And if not, may the Lord give you wisdom. And listen to the men and women in the family of God who can speak to you about those areas. As a child nears adulthood, the parent is not acting in love if he refuses to let go and attempts to control every aspect of the young person's life. From the time children are old enough to know right from wrong, parents need to be instilling in them the fact that they must answer to God. That they must render and give. They must know that they have responsibilities, moral decisions, what they choose. If you love your child, you will be able to relinquish control as the child matures without rejecting the child from making wrong choices. Amen. And may I say, one of the biggest challenges is that we still are thinking of that child when they were babies. And they're not babies anymore. And we have to. We're not rejecting them, but you have to relinquish. You have to. Deep concern. Forgiveness here for that son is deep concern. This father was constantly scanning the horizon, looking for the son's return. Chapter 15, verse 20 tells us, even though the boy had wronged his father, the father still cared deeply for his son. He didn't protect his hurt feelings by see, we have an option. We can choose to harden our hearts. And let me tell you, it will get hardened if you let it. But you can choose, just like we can choose that gift. We can choose how we're going to respond, how we're going to react. And so we can choose. He didn't protect his hard feelings by hardening. A self-focused parent would have said, after what he's done to me, I couldn't care less what happens to that ungrateful boy. But you know what the father instead, by his actions, his attitude show? I couldn't care more. I couldn't care more. There's also that forgiveness, heartfelt compassion. When he saw his boy in rags, his bare feet bloody from his journey, smelling like the pigsty in which he had worked, the father did not say, "Me das asco." How disgusting. It serves you right. I told you. Go clean up and dress properly and you can come home. No, he felt compassion. He hurt with his son. And we studied about it this morning, compassion. Jesus looked at the multitude with what? Compassion. Outward affection. Outward affection as well. Forgiveness shows us outward affection. The father ran. He embraced him. He kissed him. He doesn't even know yet whether the son is repentant. You know, one could say, oh, if he turns, I will. But notice, this son is coming and this father is ready there. Outward. And you think about it. He could have waited at the house until the boy was all the way there and then have given him an icy stare and he could have said, so you came back, huh? But he ran to him and he openly showed him his love. Dads, I'm going to say this. And it's possible that there might be moms, but I think on the average, moms tend to be more affectionate and more demonstrative with love and embrace and all that. Men, hombres, don't be afraid to show emotion. Real quick note, I thought my father had no emotions at all, except anger. I thought that was the only one, or some other stuff there, or coldness. But when I was planning to go to college, and I was with some other young men going off to one of our colleges in Massachusetts, and I had all my boxes of books. You know, usually you get books in college. I took books with me to college. And I had so much stuff. I mean, it was so many things. And my father came out and he said, "Mi hijo, my son, te vas, you're going." And then he added, "Para siempre." And when he said that, the voice went down or dropped, or actually went high. And I saw tears forming in his eyes. And I was like, I saw it for a moment, and I could see my dad was like, and he moved, because he didn't want me to see it. But I realized, my dad does have feelings, and he does love me. And we can show our children that love in so many ways, not to be afraid. Unaffected humility. You know, this father shows in his forgiveness for the son unaffected humility. In that culture, it was disgraceful for an old man to run, to move rapidly. They had this robe. He didn't care. It was like, a mí no me interesa. I don't care, and manita chismosa, I don't care what sister gossiper or nosy is saying about me. That is my son, and I will run to him, to her. That's my child. Amen? That father doesn't care. He cares for the object of his love and concern. And so, unaffected humility, he girds up his robe, he runs, he valued his son more than he cared about what other people thought about him. It's also forgiveness, undeserved generosity. He is going to pour out and lavish that son. He brought out the best robe, a ring, sandals, he killed the fatted calf. He did the boy deserve it? That's the question. Did he deserve it? No, he had already wasted what was given to him. This was pure grace. Pure grace to his other son, even though he was rude and impudent. The father said, "My son, all that I have of mine is yours." Have you said that? Let me tell you, I'm still praying. God, help me. When we had our first child, I remember I had a trophy, and it was a trophy from a competition I had been in, and he had his first little soccer ball, and he kicked that as hard as he could, and he broke that trophy, and it was like, this children are going to cost me. And you know, and I realized that more precious than any one of those things that come and go is our children. More precious. Nothing. You know? And so, all his mind, he was a generous man. And so I'm not going to say that we are not to be careful and safeguard. Yes, we have to put boundaries. Yes, we have to. It's not give them the brand new car. They may need to work for that, okay? They may need to. We may need to show them to be responsible, to care for their things. So we have to exercise wisdom with all that. Undeserved acceptance. The boy was not put on probation. He was not accepted home on the condition that he meet certain standards. True, he had repented of his wrong, the confession that he shows, but the most likely reading of verse 21 leaves off the last phrase, make me one of your hired men. The father cuts him off and showers him, with blessings to show his undeserved acceptance of his son. Although he has been hurt very deeply, the father loved his son totally. That's how God's love is toward each of us. The father is ready to forgive. It's immediate. It's total. It's forgotten. He doesn't keep a list. He doesn't bring it back. It was costly. It's also restorative. It's complete restoration. The father restored his son to the full privileges. The son is still in the past, but the father has a big perspective. Did you hear that? The child, the one who's lived wrong, is still in the past. But you and I are called to have the bigger picture in mind. And it's restorative. He did not have servant status. He was not a hired hand who had to earn his keep and could be fired. He was a son with all rights, with all privileges. Forgiveness means full restoration. Mm-hmm. It was not guilt-blame approach either. Instead of really forgiving, many people establish a scorecard of guilt and blame. To the extent that the son was guilty, the father feels justified in maintaining the blame against him. And the father excuses his own guilt by blaming the son. But you see, the father didn't do that. He truly forgave his son. It was active forgiveness and not passive. What does that mean? Passive forgiveness says, look, I'll forgive you. I'll let bygones be bygones. But it stops there. The person doesn't go on to reestablish. You might have some of those that you remember. Somebody did you wrong. You say, it's okay. But it really isn't okay. Because you have never restored that relationship. And so this father shows full. And the final thing I want to share with you, I just shared through quite a list here. There was a gentleman years ago who, by the name of Joe Bailey, he was a gentle, godly Christian leader. And this man told how one of his sons rebelled back in the days of the hippie movement. And some of you remember those days, right? He grew his hair long, and he moved into a communal flop house. And late one night, Bailey received a call informing him that his son had been held at one of the Chicago police stations. So what did the father do? He got out of bed. He went to the police station. He said, is so-and-so there? And they checked their records, and they said, I'm sorry, sir. No. There is no one by that name here. And he decided Chicago has many other police stations. So he went to all these others. And no one had his son. And he realized that was a prank. So he thought, let me go to the flop house. And he went to the flop house. And they keep the doors open all through the night. And it was a little dark, but he could see as he went in there. And he saw bodies after bodies all on the floor. Out there, they had beds on the floor and everything. And he went over each one. And then he saw his boy. And he stooped over. And he kissed him on the forehead. And covered him up. And went home. Years later, that young man came to Christ. And became a pastor. And the father one day heard his son share, and the son said, Dad, do you know what turned me around? Dad, what happened was, it was that you came and I was asleep and you planted a kiss on my forehead. And I thought, if my dad loves me that much, I had better get my life right with God. What an opportunity we have as parents. It's not over. We can learn from the story, from these lessons. We can change. We can let the love of God inform us and transform us. We can be vessels for restoration and renewal in the lives of that son, that daughter. And God is at work in them too. The one who began the good work will see it through. Amen, church? Amen. Would you stand with me in prayer? Thank you, Father, for lessons from this father and the story of the prodigal son, reminding us of your immense love for us all. We've all wandered. We've all fallen from grace. And we're grateful for that immense grace and love that you've shown and showered us in Jesus Christ. And that it is your love for us and our love for others, especially our children, that can lead them home in la familia, our homes, but especially for that day when we will all be in la casa de Dios, in the house of God. Be with us and grant us wisdom, and thank you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.